Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents The Rhaera Revelations, Book 5, Wintertide, by Michael J. Sullivan. Narrated by Bradley Foster Smith and performed by a full cast.
Some people are skilled and some are lucky, but at that moment, Mince realized he was neither. Failing to cut the merchant's purse strings, he froze with one hand still cupping the bag. He knew the pickpocket's creed allowed for only a single touch, and he had dutifully slipped into the crowd after two earlier attempts. A third failure meant they would bar him from another meal. Mince was too hungry to let go. With his hands still under the merchant's cloak, he waited. The man remained oblivious.
Should I try again?
The thought was insane, but his empty stomach won the battle over reason. In a moment of desperation, Mince pushed caution aside. The leather seemed oddly thick. Sawing back and forth, he felt the purse come loose, but something was not right. It took only an instant for Mince to realize his mistake. Instead of purse strings, he had sliced through the merchant's belt. Like a hissing snake, the leather strap slithered off the fat man's belly, dragged to the cobblestones by the weight of his weapons. Mince did not breathe or move as the entire span of his 10 disappointing years flashed by.
Huh?
The merchant turned. He was a large, soft man with saddlebag cheeks reddened by the cold. His eyes widened when he noticed the purse in Mince's hand.
Hey, you!
The man reached for his dagger, and surprise filled his face when he found it missing. Groping for his other weapon, he spotted them both lying in the street. Mince bolted. Common sense told him the best way to escape a rampaging giant was to head for the smallest crack. He plunged beneath an ale cart outside the Blue Swan Inn and slid to the far side. Scrambling to his feet, he raced for the alley, clutching the knife and purse to his chest. The recent snow hampered his flight, and his small feet lost traction rounding a corner.
Thief! Stop!
The shouts were not nearly as close as he had expected. Mince continued to run. Finally reaching the stable, he ducked between the rails of the fence, framing the manure pile. Exhausted, he crouched with his back against the far wall. The boy shoved the knife into his belt and stuffed the purse down his shirt, leaving a noticeable bulge.
There you are!
Elbright skidded in the snow and caught himself on the fence.
What an idiot. He just stood there, waiting for the fat oaf to turn around. You're a moron, Mince. That's it. That's all there is to it. I honestly don't know why I bothered trying to teach you.
Mince and the other boys refer to 13-year-old Elbright as the old man. In their small band, only he wore an actual cloak, which was dingy gray and secured with a tarnished metal brooch. Elbright was the smartest and most accomplished of their crew, and Mince hated to disappoint him. Brand arrived only moments later and joined Elbright at the fence.
It's not funny,
but he...
Like the other two, Brand was dirty, thin, and dressed in mismatched clothing of varying sizes. His pants were too long, and snow gathered in the folds of the rolled-up bottoms. A year younger than the old man, he was a tad taller and a bit broader. In the unspoken hierarchy of their gang, Brand came second, the muscle to Elbright's brains. Kine, the remaining member of their group, ranked third because he was the best pickpocket. This left Mince unquestionably at the bottom. His size matched his position, as he stood barely 4 feet tall and weighed little more than a wet cat.
Stop it, will ya? I'm trying to teach the kid a thing or two. He could have gotten himself killed. It was stupid. Plain and simple.
Oh, I thought it was brilliant. Oh, God.
Brand paused to wipe his eyes.
I mean, sure it was dumb, but spectacular. spectacular, just the same. The way Minster stood there blinking as the guy goes for his blades. But they ain't there because the little imbecile done cut the git's whole bloody belt off. Then, the best part is it just after Mince runs, the fat bastard goes to chase him and his britches fall down. The guy toppled like a ruddy tree. Wham! Right into the gutter. By Ma, that was hilarious.
Okay, quit it. Let's see the take.
Mince fished out the purse and handed it over with a wide grin.
Feels heavy.
Elbright drew open the top and scowled after examining the contents.
Just coppers.
Brand and Elbright exchanged disappointed frowns, and Mince's momentary elation melted.
It felt heavy.
Oh, what now? Do we give him another go?
No, and all of us will have to avoid Church Square for a while. Too many people saw Mince. We'll move closer to the gates. We can watch for new arrivals. And hope to get lucky.
Do you want...
No. Give me back my knife. Brand is up next.
The boys jogged toward the palace walls, following the trail that morning patrols had made in the fresh snow. They circled east and entered Imperial Square. People from all over Avron were arriving for wintertide, and the central plaza bustled with likely prospects.
There.
Elbright pointed toward the city gate.
Those two. See him? One tall, the other shorter.
They're a sorry-looking pair. Exhausted.
Probably been riding all night in the storm.
Elbright smiled hungrily.
Go on, Brand. Do the old helpful stable boy routine. Now, Mince, watch how this is done. It might be your only hope, as you've got no talent for purse cutting.
Royce and Hadrian entered Imperial Square on ice-laden horses. Defending against the cold, the two appeared as ghosts, shrouded in snowy blankets. Despite wearing all they had, they were ill-equipped for the winter roads, much less the mountain passes that lay between Ratibor and Equesta. The all-night snowstorm had only added to their hardship. As the two drew their horses to a stop, Royce noticed Hadrian breathing into his cupped hands. Neither of them had winter gloves. Hadrian had wrapped his fingers in torn strips from his blanket, while Royce opted for pulling his hands into the shelter of his sleeves. The sight of his own handless arms disturbed Royce as they reminded him of the old wizard. The two had learned the details of his murder while passing through Ratibor. Assassinated late one night, Ezra Hadden had been silenced forever. They had meant to get gloves, but as soon as they had arrived in Ratibor, they saw announcements proclaiming the nationalist leader's upcoming execution. The Empire planned to publicly burn Deegan Gaunt in the Imperial capital of Equesta as part of the Wintertide celebrations. After Hadrian and Royce had spent months traversing high seas and dark jungles seeking Gaunt, to have found his whereabouts tacked up to every tavern door in the city was as much a blow as a blessing. Fearing some new calamity might arise to stop them from finally reaching him, they left early the next morning, long before the trade shops opened. Unwrapping his scarf, Royce drew back his hood and looked around. The snow-covered palace took up the entire southern side of the square, while shops and vendors dominated the rest. Colorful banners were everywhere, announcing the upcoming festival. Royce had just dismounted when a boy ran up.
Take your horses, sirs. One night in the stable for just a silver each. I'll brush them down myself and see they get good oats, too.
Dismounting and pulling back his own hood, Hadrian smiled at the boy.
Will you sing them a lullaby at night?
The boy didn't lose a beat.
Certainly, sir. It'll cost you 2 coppers more, but I do have a very fine voice, I does.
Any stable in the city will quarter a horse for 5 coppers.
Oh, not this month, sir. Wintertide pricing started 3 days back. Stables and rooms fill up fast, especially this year. You're lucky you got here early. In another 2 weeks, they'll be stocking horses in the fields behind hunters' blinds. The only lodgings will be on dirt floors where people will be stacked like cordwood for 5 silvers each. I know the best places and the lowest costs in the city. A silver is a good price right now. In a few days, it'll cost you twice that.
Royce eyed him closely.
What's your name?
The boy straightened up, adjusting the collar of his tunic.
Brand the Bold, they call me.
Why is that?
Because I don't never back down from a fight, sir.
Well, Brand, do you think you can take these horses to the Bailey Inn at Hall and Coswall and stable them there?
I could indeed, sir. And a fine choice, I might add. It's run by a reputable owner charging fair prices. I was just going to suggest that very place.
Royce gave him a smirk. He turned his attention to two boys who stood at a distance, pretending not to know Brand. Royce waved for them to come over. The boys appeared hesitant, but when he repeated the gesture, they reluctantly obliged.
What are your names?
Elbright, sir.
The taller of the two was older than Brand and had a knife concealed beneath his cloak. Royce guessed he was the real leader of their group and had sent Brand over to make the play.
Mince, sir.
The other boy looked to be the youngest. He wore little more than rags of stained, worn wool. His shirt and pants exposed the bright pink skin of his wrists and shins. Of all his clothing, the item that fit best was a torn, woven bag draped over his shoulders. The same material wrapped his feet, secured around his ankles by twine. Hadrian checked through the gear on his horse, removed his spadone blade, and slid it into the sheath, which he wore on his back beneath his cloak. Royce handed two silver tenants to the first boy.
Brand here is going to have our horses stabled at a bailey and reserve us a room. While he's gone, you two will stay here and answer some questions.
But, sir, we can't...
When Brand returns with a receipt from the bailey, I will pay each of you a silver. If he doesn't return, if instead he runs off and sells the horses, I shall slit both of your throats and hang you on the palace gate by your feet. I'll let your blood drip into a pail, then paint a sign with it to notify the city that Brand the Bold is a horse thief. Then I'll track him down with the help of the Imperial Guard and other connections I have in this city and see he gets the same treatment.
Royce glared at the boy.
Do we understand each other, Brand?
The three boys stared at him with mouths agape.
By Ma, not a very trusting fellow, are you, sir?
Royce grinned ominously.
Make the reservation under the names of Grimm and Baldwin. Run along now, Brand, but do hurry back. You don't want your friends to worry.
Brand led the horses away while the other two boys watched him go. Elbright gave a little shake of his head when Brand looked back.
Now, boys, why don't you tell us what is planned for this year's festivities?
Well, I suspect this will be the most memorable winter tide in 100 years, on account of the Empress's marriage and all.
Marriage?
Yes, sir. I thought everyone knew about that. Invitations went out months ago, and all the rich folk, even kings and queens, have been coming from all over.
Who's she marrying?
Lord Ethelred.
Shut it, Mince.
He's a snake.
Elbright cuffed the youngest boy on the ear.
Talk like that will get you dead.
He turned back to Royce and Hadrian.
Mince has a bit of a crush on the Empress. He's not too pleased with the old king, on account of him marrying her and all.
She's like a goddess, she is. I seen her once. I climbed to that roof for a better view when she gave a speech last summer. Oh, she shimmered like a star, she did. By Ma, she's beautiful. You can tell she's the daughter of Novren. I've never seen anyone so pretty.
See what I mean? Mint is a bit crazy when it comes to the Empress. He's got to get used to Regent Ethelred running things again. Not that he ever really stopped, on account of the Empress being sick and all.
She was hurt by the beast she killed up north. Empress Medina was dying from the poison, and healers came from all over, and no one could help. Then Regent Soldier prayed for 7 days and nights without food or water. Maribor showed him that the pure heart of a servant girl named Amelia from Terrenvale had the power to heal the Empress. And she did. Lady Amelia has been nursing the Empress back to health and doing a fine job. She...
Mince, enough.
What's all this about?
Royce pointed at bleachers that were being built in the center of the square.
They aren't holding the wedding out here, are they?
No. The wedding will be at the cathedral. Those are for folks to watch the execution. They're gonna kill the rebel leader.
Yeah, that piece of news we heard about.
Elbright looked to Hadrian.
Oh, so you came for the execution?
More or less.
I've got our spots all picked out. I'm gonna have Mince go up the night before and save us a good seat.
Why? Why do I have to go?
Brand and I have to carry all the stuff. You're too small to help. And Kine's still sick, so you need to...
But you have the cloak and it's gonna be cold just sitting up there.
The two boys went on arguing, but Royce could tell Hadrian was no longer listening. His friend's eyes scanned the palace gates, walls, and front entrance. Hadrian was counting guards. Rooms at the Bailey were the same as at every inn, small and drab, with worn wooden floors and musty odors. A small pile of firewood was stacked next to the hearth in each room, but never enough for the whole night. Patrons were forced to buy more at exorbitant prices if they wanted to stay warm. Royce made his usual rounds, circling the block, watching for faces that appeared too many times. He returned to their room confident that no one had noticed their arrival. At least, no one who mattered.
Room 8. Been here almost a week.
A week? Why so early?
If you were living in a monastery for 10 months a year, wouldn't you show up early for wintertide?
Hadrian grabbed his swords, and the two moved down the hall. Royce picked the lock of a weathered door and slid it open. On the far side of the room, two candles burned on a small table set with plates, glasses, and a bottle of wine. A man, dressed in velvet and silk, stood before a wall mirror, checking the tie that held back his blonde hair and adjusting the high collar of his coat.
Looks like he was expecting us.
Looks like he was expecting someone.
What the...
Startled, Albert Winslow spun around.
Would it hurt to knock?
What can I say?
Royce flopped on the bed.
We're scoundrels and thieves.
Scoundrels, certainly. But thieves? When was the last time you two stole anything?
Do I detect dissatisfaction?
I'm a Viscount. I have a reputation to uphold, which takes a certain amount of income. Money that I don't receive when you two are idle.
Hadrian took a seat at the table.
He's not dissatisfied. He's outright scolding us.
Is that why you're here so early? Scouting for work?
Partially. I also needed to get away from the Wind's Abbey. I'm becoming a laughingstock. When I contacted Lord Dereff, he couldn't lay off the Viscount monk jokes. On the other hand, Lady May does find my pious reclusion appealing.
And is she the one who...
Hadrian swirled a finger at the neatly arranged table.
Yes, yes, I was about to fetch her.
Albert looked from one to the other.
I'm going to have to cancel, aren't I?
Sorry.
I hope this job pays well. This is a new doublet, and I still owe the tailor.
Blowing out the candles, he took a seat across from Hadrian.
How are things up north?
Albert pursed his lips, thinking.
I'm guessing you know about Medford being taken. Imperial troops hold it and most of the provincial castles, except for Drondel Fields.
Royce sat up.
No, we didn't know. How's Gwen?
I have no idea. I was here when I heard.
So Ulrich and Arista are at Drondel Fields?
King Ulrich is, but I don't think the princess was in Medford. I believe she's running Ratibor. They appointed her mayor, or so I've heard.
No, we just came through there. She was governing after the battle, but left months ago in the middle of the night. No one knows why. I just assumed she went home.
Maybe. But I never heard anything about her going back. Probably better for her if she didn't. The imps have Drondel Fields surrounded. Nothing is going in or out. It's only a matter of time before Ulrich will have to surrender.
What about the Abbey? Has the Empire come knocking?
Not that I know of. But like I said, I was already here when the Imperialists crossed the Galewar.
Royce got up and began to pace.
Anything else?
Rumor has it that Tur del Fur was invaded by goblins. But that's only a rumor as far as I can tell.
Not a rumor.
Oh?
We were there. Actually, we were responsible.
Sounds interesting.
Royce stopped his pacing.
Don't get him started.
Okay, so what brings you to Equesta? I'm guessing it's not to celebrate Wintertide.
We're going to break Deegan Gaunt out of the palace dungeon, and we'll need you for the usual inside work.
Really? You do know he's going to be executed on Wintertide, don't you?
Yeah, that's why we need to get moving.
Are you crazy? the palace at Wintertide? You've heard about this little wedding that's going on. Security might be a tad tighter than usual.
Your point?
We should be able to use the wedding to our advantage. Anyone we know in town yet?
Jenny and Leo arrived recently, I think.
Really? That's perfect. Get in touch. They'll have rooms in the palace for sure. See if they can get you in. Then find out all you can, especially about where they're keeping Gaunt.
I'm going to need money. I was only planning to attend a few local balls and maybe one of the feasts. If you want me inside the palace, I'll have to get better clothes. By Ma, look at my shoes. Just look at them. I can't meet the Empress in these.
Borrow from Jenny and Leo for now. I'm going to leave for Medford tonight and return with funds to cover our expenses.
You're going back tonight? But you just got here, didn't you?
The thief nodded.
She's okay, Royce. I'm sure she got out.
We've got nearly a month to Wintertide. I should be back in a week or so. In the meantime, learn what you can, and we'll formulate a plan when I return.
Albert frowned.
Well, at least Wintertide won't be boring.
Someone was whimpering. It was a man's voice this time, one that Arista had heard before. Everyone cried eventually. Some people even broke down into fits of hysterics. There used to be a woman who was prone to screaming, but she had been removed some time earlier. Arista held no illusions of the woman being set free. She had heard them drag the body away. The whimpering man used to cry out, but had grown quieter over the past few days. He never wailed anymore. Although not long before she had heard him praying, Arista was surprised that he did not ask for rescue or even a quick death. All he prayed for was her. He asked Maribor to keep her safe, but in all his ramblings, the princess never caught the name of the man's lover. There was no way to track the passage of time in the dark. Arista tried counting meals, but her hunger suggested they came less than once per day. Still, weeks must have passed since her capture. In all that time, she had never heard Gaunt, despite having called out to him. The only time she had heard his voice was the night she and Hilfred had failed to rescue him. Since then, she had been confined to her cell, which contained only a pail for waste and a few handfuls of straw. The room was so small that she could touch all four walls at once, making it feel like a cage or a grave. Arista knew that Modena, the girl once known as Thrace, had been kept somewhere just like that, perhaps even in that very cell. After she had lost everyone and everything that mattered to her, it would have been a nightmare to wake alone in the dark without explanation, cause, or reason. Not knowing where she was or how she had gotten there must have driven the girl mad. Despite her own tragedies, at least Arista knew she was not alone in the world. Once the news of her disappearance reached him, her brother, Ulrich, would move the world to save her. He might even call on Royce and Hadrian, whom Ulrich affectionately referred to as the royal protectors.
It won't be long now.
Arista pictured Hadrian's lopsided smile. The image stung, but her mind refused to let it go. Memories of the sound of his voice, the touch of his hand, and that tiny scar on his chin pulled at her heart. There had been moments of warmth, but only kindness on his part, only sympathy, compassion for a person in pain or need. To him, Arista was just the princess, his employer, his job, just one more desperate noble.
How empty an existence I've led that those few I count among my best friends are two people I paid to work for me.
The deep rumble of stone against stone echoed through the corridors. Footsteps sounded in the hall. Someone was coming. Now was not the time for food. While Arista could not count the days in the darkness, she knew food never came until she feared it might never come. They fed her so little that she welcomed the thin, putrid soup, which smelled of rotten eggs. A key rattled against the assembly of her lock. A bright light made Arista wince. A guard entered, jerked her roughly to one side, and attached a pair of iron bracelets, chaining her wrists to the wall. Leaving her sitting with her arms above her head, the guard exited but left the door open. A moment later, Regent Salder entered holding a lantern.
How are you this evening, Princess?
The old man shook his head sadly.
Oh, look at you, my dear. You are so thin and filthy. And where in Maribor's name did you get that dress? Not that there's much left of it, is there? Those look like new bruises, too. Have the guards been raping you? No, I suppose not. They had extremely strict orders not to touch Modena when she was here. I accused an innocent jailer of improperly touching her, and then had him pulled apart by oxen as an example. There were no problems after that. It might seem extreme, but I couldn't have a pregnant empress now, could I? Of course, in your case, I don't really care. But the guards don't know that.
Why are you here?
Her low, raspy voice sounded strange, even to her.
I thought I would bring you some news, my dear. Kilna and Vaness have fallen. Renyard is now a happy member of the Empire. The farmlands of Meranon on the Delgos Peninsula had a nice harvest, so we'll have plenty of supplies to feed our troops all winter. We've retaken Ratabor, but had to execute quite a few traitors as examples. The peasants must learn the consequences of rebellion. They were cursing your name before we had finished.
Arista knew he was telling the truth. Not because she could read his face, which she barely saw through her matted hair, but because Salder had no reason to lie.
What do you want?
Two things, really. I want you to realize that the new empire has risen and nothing can stand in its way. Your life, Arista, is over. You will be executed in a matter of weeks, and your dreams are already dead. You need to bury them alongside the sad little graves of Hilfred and Emery.
Arista stiffened.
Surprised? We learned all about Emery when we retook Ratibor. You really do have such a way with men. First you got him killed, and then Hilfred as well. You must make Black Widow's chalice.
And the second?
She noticed his momentary confusion.
The other reason we're having this little chat.
Oh, yes. I want to know who you were working with.
Hilfred. You killed him for it, remember?
Salder smiled, and then struck her hard across the face. The chains binding Arista's wrists snapped taut as she tried to protect herself.
You're a smart girl. Too smart for your own good. But you're not that smart. Hilfred may have helped you escape arrest. He might even have hidden you for those weeks we searched. But he couldn't have gotten you into the palace or found this prison. Hilfred died wearing the uniform of a fourth floor guard. You must have had help from someone on the staff to get that. And I want to know who it was.
There was no one. It was just me and Hilfred.
Don't lie to me.
He raised his hand again.
I told you it was just me. I got a job working in the palace as a chambermaid. I stole the uniform.
I know all about your posing as Ella the Scrub Girl, but you couldn't have gotten the uniform without help. It had to be someone in a position of authority. I must know who the traitor is. Now tell me, who was helping you?
She said nothing.
Stop it.
Tell me.
No, you'll hurt her.
Her?
Realizing her mistake, Arista bit her lip.
So it was a woman. That limits the possibilities considerably now, doesn't it?
Salter played with a key that dangled from a small chain, spinning it around his index finger. After several minutes, the regent crouched down and placed the lantern on the floor.
I need a name, and you will tell me. I know you think you can carry her identity to your grave, but whether you hold your tongue out of loyalty to her or to spite me, you should reconsider. You might believe that a few weeks is not long to hold your tongue, but once we start, you'll wish for a quick death.
He brushed her hair aside.
Look at that face. You don't believe me, do you? Still so naive. Still such an optimistic child. As a princess, you've led such a pampered life. Do you think that living among the commoners of Ratibor and scrubbing floors here at the palace has made you strong? Do you think you have nothing else to lose and you finally hit bottom?
When he stroked her cheek, Arista recoiled.
I can see by your expression that you still have some pride and a sense of nobility. You don't yet realize just how far you have to fall. Trust me, Arista, I can strip you of that courage and break your spirit. You don't want to find out just how low I can bring you.
He stroked her hair gently for a moment, then grabbed a handful. Salder pulled hard, jerking her head back and forcing Arista to look at him. His gaze lingered on her face.
Oh, you're still pure, aren't you? Still untouched and locked in your tower in more ways than one. I suspect neither Emery nor Hilfred dared to bed a princess. Perhaps we should begin with that. I will let the guards know that they can... No! I will specifically order them to violate you. It will make both of us very popular. The men will be requesting extra duty so they can desecrate you night and day.
Salder let go of her hair, allowing her head to drop.
Once you are thoroughly used and your pride has evaporated, I'll send for the Master Inquisitor. I'm sure he will relish the opportunity to purge the evil from the infamous Witch of Melengar.
Salder moved closer.
The Inquisitor is very imaginative. And what he can do with chains, a bucket of water, and a searing hot brand is sheer artistry. You'll scream until you lose your voice. You'll black out and wake where the nightmare left off.
Arista tried to turn away, but his wrinkled hands forced her to look at him once again. His expression was not pleased or maniacal. Salder appeared grim, almost sad.
You'll experience anguish that you never thought possible. Your remaining courage will evaporate into myth and memory. Your mind will abandon you, leaving behind a drooling lump of scarred flesh. Even the guards won't want you then.
Salder leaned forward until she could feel his breath and feared he might kiss her.
If, after all that, you've still not given me what I want, I will turn my attention to that pleasant little family who took you in. The Barkers, wasn't it? I will have them arrested and brought here. The father will watch as his wife takes your place with the guards. Then she will witness her husband and sons drawn and quartered one by one. Imagine what it will do to the woman when she sees her youngest, the one you supposedly saved, die. She will blame you, Arista. That poor woman will curse your name, and rightly so, for it will be your silence that destroyed her life.
He gently patted Arista's burning cheek.
Don't force me to do it. Tell me the traitor's name. She is guilty of treason, but the poor Barkers are innocent. They have done nothing. Simply tell me the name of this woman, and you can prevent all these horrors.
Arista found it difficult to think and fought for breath as she started losing control. Her face throbbed from his blows, and she was sickened by the salty, metallic taste of blood in her mouth. Guilt conjured images of Emery and Hilfred, both of whom had died because of her. She could not bear to add the Barkers' blood to her hands, to have them suffer for her mistakes.
I'll tell you. But in return, I want your assurance that nothing will happen to the Barkers.
Salder looked sympathetic, and she could almost see the grandfatherly face from her youth.
Of course, my dear. After all, I'm not a monster. Just give me what I want, and none of those things will come to pass. Now, tell me, what is her name?
Arista hesitated. Salder lost his smile once again. Her time was up. She swallowed.
There was someone who hid me, gave me food, and even helped to find Gaunt. She's been a true friend, so kind and selfless. I can't believe I'm betraying her to you now.
Her name?
Tears ran from Arista's eyes as she looked up.
Her name is... Edith Mon.
Archibald Ballantyne, the Earl of Chadwick, stared out the windows of the Imperial Throne Room. Behind him, Salder shuffled parchments at a table, while Ethelred warmed a throne not yet his own. A handful of servants occasionally drifted in and out, as did the Imperial Chancellor, who briefly spoke with one regent or the other. No one ever spoke to Archibald or asked for his counsel. In just a few short years, Regent Salder had risen from Bishop of Medford to the architect of the new empire. Ethelred was about to trade his king's crown of Warwick for the imperial scepter of all Avren. Even the commoner Merrick Marius had managed to secure a noble fief, wealth, and a title.
What do I have to show for all my contributions? Where is my crown? My wife? My glory?
The answers Archibald knew all too well. He would wear no crown. Ethelred would wed his wife. And as for his glory, the man who had stolen that was just entering the hall. Turning around, Archibald saw Sir Brecton Belstrid's floor-length blue cape sweeping behind the knight. Holding his helm in the crook of one arm and wearing a metal breastplate, he looked as if he were just returning from battle. Sir Brecton was tall, his shoulders broad, his chin chiseled. He was a leader of men, victorious in battle, and Archibald hated him.
Sir Brecton, welcome to Equesta.
Brecton ignored Ethelred and Salder as well, walking directly to Archibald's side, where he stomped dramatically and dropped to one knee.
Your lordship.
The Earl of Chadwick waved a hand at him.
Yes, yes, get up.
As always, I'm at your service, my lord.
Sir Brecton.
Brecton showed no sign of acknowledging Ethelred.
You called, my lord? What is it you wish of me?
Actually, I summoned you on behalf of Regent Ethelred. He wishes to speak with you.
The knight stood.
As you wish, my lord.
Brecton turned and crossed the distance to the throne. He stopped at the base of the steps and offered only a shallow bow. Ethelred scowled, but only briefly.
Sir Brecton, at long last. I've sent summons for you 6 times over the past several weeks. Have the messages not reached you?
They have, your lordship.
But you did not respond.
No, your lordship.
Why?
My lord, the Earl of Chadwick commanded me to take Melengar. I was following his orders.
Ethelred nodded.
So the crucial demands of battle prevented you from breaking away until now?
No, your lordship. Only the fall of Drondil Fields remains, and the siege is well tended. Victory is assured and does not require my attention.
Then I don't understand. Why didn't you come when I ordered you to appear before me?
I do not serve you, your lordship. I serve the Earl of Chadwick.
Archibald's disdain for Brecton did not diminish his delight at seeing Ethelred verbally slapped.
May I remind you, Sir Knight, that I will be Emperor in just a few weeks.
You may, Your Lordship.
Ethelred looked confused. This brought a smile to Archibald's face. He enjoyed seeing someone else trying to deal with Brecton and knew exactly how the regent felt. Was Brecton granting Ethelred permission to remind the knight, or had he just insinuated the regent might not be emperor? Either way, the comment was rude, yet spoken so plainly and respectfully that it appeared innocent of any ill intent. Brecton was like that, politely confounding and pointedly confusing. He had a way of making Archibald feel stupid, and that was just one of the many reasons he despised the arrogant man.
I see this is going to continue to be an issue. This demonstrates the point of this meeting. As Emperor, I will require good men to help me reign. You have proven yourself a capable leader, and as such, I want you to serve me directly. I am prepared to offer you the office and title of Grand Marshal of all Imperial forces. In addition, I'll grant you the province of Melengar.
What?
Archibald staggered.
Melengar is mine, or will be when it's taken. It was promised to me.
Yes, Archie, but times change. I need a strong man in the north defending my border.
Ethelred looked at Brecton.
I will appoint you the Marquis of Melengar. All too fitting, given that you were responsible for taking it.
Archibald stomped his foot.
This is outrageous. We had a deal. You have the Imperial Crown and Salda has the Imperial Mitre. What do I get? What is a reward for all my sweat and sacrifice? Without me, you wouldn't have Melengar to bestow to anyone.
Don't make a fool of yourself, Archie.
Salder smiled gently at him.
You must have known we could never entrust such an important realm to you. You were too young, too inexperienced, too weak.
There was silence as Archibald fumed.
Well?
Ethelred turned his attention back to Brecton.
Marquis of Melengar? Grand Marshal of the Imperial Host? What say you?
Sir Brecton showed no emotion.
I serve the Earl of Chadwick, just as my father and grandfather before me. It does not appear he wishes this. If there is nothing else, I must return to my charge in Melengar.
Sir Brecton pivoted sharply and strode back to Archibald, where he knelt once more. Ethelred stared after him in shock.
Don't leave a question just yet, Sir Brecton. I may have need of you here.
As you wish, my lord.
Brecton stood and briskly departed. They were silent as they listened to the knight's footfalls fade. Ethelred's face turned scarlet and he clenched his fists. Salder stared after Brecton with his usual irritated glare.
It seems you didn't take into account the man's unwavering sense of loyalty when you made your plans. But then, how could you, seeing as you obviously don't understand the meaning of the word yourself? You should have consulted me first. I would have told you what the result would be. But you couldn't do that, could you? No, because it was me you were plotting to stab in the back.
Bishop Salder held up a hand.
Calm down, Archie.
Stop calling me that. My name is Archibald.
Spit flew from the Earl's lips.
You're both so smug and arrogant, but I'm no pawn. One word from me and Brecton will turn his army and march on Equesta.
The Earl pointed toward the still open door.
They're loyal to him, you know. Every last one of the miserable cretins. They will do whatever he says, and as you can see, he worships me.
He clenched his fists and advanced.
I could get King Alric to throw his support behind me as well. I could return his precious Melengar in exchange for the rest of Avril. I could beat you at your own little game. I'd have the Northern Imperial Army in my right hand and what remains of the Royalists in my left. I could crush both of you in less than a month. So don't tell me to calm down, Solly. I've had it with your condescending tone and your holier-than-thou attitude. You're as much a worm as Ethelred. You're both in this together, weaving your webs and plotting against me.
You just may have caught your own selves in your sticky trap this time.
He headed for the door.
Archibald!
The Earl did not pause as he swept past Chancellor Biddings, who was just outside the throne room, and gave the Earl a concerned look. Servants scattered before Archibald as he marched in a fury through the doorway to the inner ward. He would finally have respect now that they realized just how important he was. The regents would have no clue that he could not deliver on his threats, so they would try to placate him with a larger prize. In the end, Archibald would have Melengar, and perhaps more. The Duchess of Rochelle was a large woman and more than just girth. Her husband matched her, as they were both rotund people with thick necks, short, pudgy fingers, and cheeks that jiggled when they laughed, which in the case of the lady was often and loud. They were like bookends to each other, a male and female version cut from the same cloth in every way except temperament. While the Duke was quiet, Lady Genevieve was anything but. Amelia had met the Duke and Duchess when they first arrived. Salder was there and had made the mistake of trying to explain why an audience with the Empress was not possible. Amelia had been able to excuse herself, but she was certain Salder had not been so lucky and probably was delayed for hours. Since then, Amelia had been avoiding the Duchess, as the woman was not one to take no for an answer, and she did not want to repeat Salder's mistake. After 3 days, Amelia's luck finally ran out when she was leaving the chapel.
Amelia, darling!
The Duchess rushed forward with her elegant gown billowing behind her. When she reached Amelia, two huge arms surrounded the Imperial Secretary in a crushing embrace.
I've been looking for you everywhere. Every time I inquire, I'm told you are busy. They must work you to death.
The Duchess released her grip.
Oh, you poor thing. Let me look at you.
She took Amelia's hands and spread her arms wide.
Oh, my, how lovely you are. But, darling, please tell me this is a wash day and your servants are behind. No, 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 don't bother. I am certain that is the case. Still, I hope you won't mind if I have Lois, my seamstress, whip you up something. I do so love giving gifts, and it's wintertide after all. By the look of you, it will hardly take any material or time. Lois will be thrilled.
Lady Genevieve took Amelia's arm and walked her down the hall.
You really are a treasure, you know. But I can tell they treat you poorly. What can you expect with men like Ethered and Salder running the show? Everything will be fine, though, now that I'm here.
They rounded a corner, and Amelia was amazed by the woman's ability to talk so quickly without seeming to take a breath.
Oh, I just loved the invitation you sent me, and yes, I know it was all your doing. It's all been your doing, hasn't it? They have you planning the whole wedding, don't they? No wonder you are so busy. How insensitive, how cruel. But don't worry, as I said, I'm here to help you. I've fashioned many weddings in my day, and they've all been wonderful. What you need is an experienced planner, a wizard of wonder. We aristocrats expect panache and dazzle at these events, and we hate to be disappointed. Being that this is the wedding of the Empress, it must be larger, grander, and more amazing than anything that has come before. Nothing less will suffice.
The Duchess stopped suddenly and peered at Amelia.
Do you have doves to release? Oh, you must have them. You simply must.
Amelia thought to reply, but the concern fled the Duchess's face before she had a chance. Lady Genevieve was walking once more, pulling Amelia along.
Oh, I don't want to frighten you, darling. There is still plenty of time, given the proper help, of course. I am here now, and Mordina will be thrilled at what we will achieve together. It will simply astound her. How many white horses have you arranged for? Not nearly enough, I'm sure. Never mind, it will all come together. You'll see.
The Duchess paused again, still gripping her arm like a cider press.
Thank Maribor I brought my full retinue. Lord knows the local artisans could never keep up with me. When you think about it, who can?
Amelia wondered just how much longer she could go on. With another pull, they were off again.
I tend to be a bit much, don't I? It's the way I am. I can't help it. My husband stopped trying to turn me into a proper wife years ago. Of course, now he knows that my exuberance is what he loves most about me. Never a dull moment or a moment's peace, he always says. Oh, speaking of men, have you chosen a champion to carry your favor in the joust?
No.
You haven't? Oh, but darling, knights just adore fighting for pretty young things like you. I'll bet you've driven them mad by waiting so long.
There was a pause, which startled Amelia into speech.
I didn't know I was supposed to.
Oh, you are a marvel, darling. Simply fabulous. Etherid tells me you're new to the gentry, elevated by Maribor himself. Isn't that delightful? Maribor's chosen one watching over Maribor's heir. How amazing.
They turned the corner into the west wing, where a handful of chambermaids scattered like pigeons before a carriage.
You're a living legend, dear Amelia. Why, every knight in the kingdom will clamor for your favor. There'll be none more sought after, except the Empress herself, of course. But no one would dare insult Etherid by asking for her favor just weeks before his wedding. No one wants to make an enemy of the new Emperor. That makes you the darling of the festival. You can have your pick of any eligible bachelor. Dukes, princes, earls, counts, and barons are all hoping for a chance to capture your attention or win the honor of sitting next to you at the feast with a victory on the field of High Court.
I wasn't planning on going to Ivar.
Nonsense! You must attend the feasts. Besides, it's your duty. Your absence could very well start a riot. You don't want to be the cause of an insurrection in the weeks leading to your Empress's wedding, do you?
Of course.
Oh, good. So it's all settled. Map, you just need to pick someone. Do you have a favorite?
I don't know any of them.
None? Good gracious, darling. Do they keep you a prisoner? What about Sir Elgar or Sir Murthers? Oh, Prince Rudolph is competing, and he is a fine choice with an excellent future. Of course, there is also Sir Breton. You couldn't find a better choice than that. I know he does have the reputation of being a bit stuffy. It is true, of course. But after his victory in Melengar, he's the hero of the hour. And quite dashing.
The Duchess wiggled her eyebrows.
Yes, Breton would be a perfect choice. Why, the ladies of several courts have been fawning over him for years.
A look of concern crossed Lady Genevieve's face.
Oh, that does bring up a point. You probably need to be careful. While you are certainly the object of every knight's affections, that means you're also the target of every lady's jealousy.
The Duchess threw a meaty arm around Amelia's neck and pulled her close.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.